Good morning, everyone. Thanks for joining us at the 2016 EDCO Annual Luncheon. I'm Deschutes County Commissioner Tony DeBone, and honored to be president of the Economic Development of Central Oregon's Board of Directors. I wanted to share with you that 2016 is Deschutes County's centennial anniversary. This tri-county area was all Crook County. Jefferson was created in 1914, and then Deschutes in 1916. We're are the youngest county in the state of Oregon. And while you'd not hear that auga horn much even in those days, it's a great audio reminder of how much things have changed in our region in the last century. More than 100 years ago, before rail access and even before the large-scale logging activities, we had ranchers from the vast territories of Shanico that would migrate in the summers to the banks of the Metolius and place that we call Camp Sherman today. The Stearns Ranch in Primeville would say goodbye to the cowboys after their summertime journey with their cattle herds past the river bend to the grazing land south of Lava Butte, even before there was paved roads. The vast majority of people and goods moved from one community to another on horseback, eventually by train, then cars and truck. Today, 500,000 people every year travel to and from our region via commercial air service, which doesn't even include our newest nonstop flight to Phoenix that starts in June. Yeah, let's hear it. EDCO's focused on the prosperous communities and quality jobs for Central Oregonians. We do that through business development, helping employers move here, start new enterprises, and grow existing companies. Uniquely in the Northwest, we do that with both regional organization and local offices staffed with outstanding professionals. If you want to move a business to Prineville, if you are looking for industrial property in Oregon's newest city, Lapine, if you'd like to launch a new venture, if you're thinking of setting up shop in Sisters, if you need industrial space in Redmond, if you're looking for a place to build at the airport in Jefferson County, if you want to grow your business in Bend, if you want to join an association for your industry, EDCO represents our entire Central Oregon area with its six offices. At this point, I know everybody's enjoying their salads, but anybody that's currently on the board of directors, has been on the board of directors, some of the advisory boards, if you could please stand real quick, there has been a lot of participation by our Central Oregon community in EDCO. We want to give you a little bit of acknowledgement. And I'm sure there's more out there. None of this work is possible without you, our members and sponsors and contributors to EDCO. There's no dedicated funding source for this important work, which is moving the needle in a positive direction for our economy. If you are not a member, we ask that you join this effort with us that's having such a positive impact. At this time, I'd like to introduce our Executive Director, Roger Lee, with some information about these current results. Thank you, Roger.
Thanks so much, Tony. It's great to see such a great crowd here today. So thanks for making this part of your week. So first of all, I'd like to start off by thanking our sponsors. This is an event that does not happen without sponsorship. It really is something that is a critical part of everything that happens. And Aaron Riley, thank you for all the work that you do and helping work with our sponsors. So first of all, our title sponsor coming back again is OSU Cascades. Our keynote speaker, Jones and Roth, again back. And I really want to shout out to those two organizations that have been longtime supporters in many ways. We also have great event sponsors this year, Bank of the Cascades. Thank you again for sponsoring the annual luncheon this year. And Brian Loveland Jarvis, one of the oldest law firms here in the area. We also like to thank Business Oregon, one of our partners in economic development, for helping sponsor the event. As well as our supporting sponsors, the River House, doing an awesome job today. And we just really couldn't do this event really in the Central Oregon region without the River House and this venue. And also like to thank Matt Hand and Hand in Hand and his group that actually do all the AV It was taking me back, seeing the screens all lined up back there to days when we actually used to try to do this ourselves, and I'm so glad to have them back in the room making everything, sure everything works. Just a couple of words here. In the interest of time, we're going to try to give the most time possible to our speakers. They've got great information, and they've come a long way to provide that. And so you have this little flyer here that was on your chairs. Just tell a little bit about what's going on, a few stories there. And in the center, you've got some information about our results. And I will say that we track every quarter 62 points of data as far as how we're doing both on effort and outcome and results. But this is about as small and distilled as we can get, and I think really our success of our organization is measured by you, our members, and members of the community, by how many jobs were created by the companies we're working with, what kind of capital investment is helping support our tax base here, and then, how many companies and what's the diversification of those industries. So that's about as small as we could make it, and I'd encourage you to just take a look at this. You've kind of got pictures on the front and stories on the back, a little bit about what we're doing. So hopefully, you've got a feeling and at least a bit of a taste that we really are moving the needle, I think, here in Central Oregon. And I look around the room and I say it's definitely we. Economic development is always a team sport. We have a great group of volunteers with the organization, but I look across and I see many, many companies who are involved with EDCOs in different ways in our different offices. So thank you for really making this a successful team effort. What we've got coming up here is in addition to that publication, we've got some videos to kind of tell the story, and we're going to get that rolling here now. So. Our first video, I'm going to talk, Nosler is actually going to represent our move portion, and it's certainly not new to Central Oregon, but their acquisition and relocation of a Washington-based manufacturer is our featured move story of the year, and so here's their story.
I'm Bob Nosler, I'm president and CEO of Nosler Incorporated. My dad founded the company in 1948. I took it over in 1988. And now John, my son, has taken it over as the third generation. We moved to Bend in 1957. Been here since then. Loved the country, loved the place. And now we're in Redmond. So we're glad to be here.
Nosler, if for those of you who don't know, is a bullet manufacturing company. We make ammunition, we make cases for reloading and ammunition, as well as rifles. And when we bought this company in Washington, things were going okay. But then we had workforce issues because where it was located in Washington, very small workforce. We wanted to bring it closer to home, but where we live right now, in Bend, we didn't have any area to really grow. And this is a growing part of our business. And the search kind of started at that point to find a location that would allow us to really grow and see what this side of our business could do. And so the search started. It wasn't immediate, bring it to Central Oregon. It was kind of move it closer to Washington. And after an extensive search, we're Central Oregonians. We want to stay here. And so we had to start looking for a place to call home for that business. So the big question is, why did we select this site? And it like I said, it was an extensive search. And we have certain requirements for this part of our business, and it required a lot of land. And where are you going to find a lot of land in Central Oregon? It's not the easiest thing. And we asked some people, we were trying to do some private searches, and at this point, something came up of there's a lot of acreage out in Redmond. Great. That's not that far away from our current home base, and we can really utilize a new workforce because we've been trying to get more people from northern Central Oregon to come to Bend, but it's a harder commute. What a great opportunity. And this is where EDCO really stepped in and helped guide us on the process, and it allowed this 60-acre purchase to happen as well as the building.
We have 182 employees in Bend and Redmond, 9 new employees from Redmond right here. This is our brass and ammunition manufacturing site, and we're really proud of it because it's come a long way in a short period of time. A lot of help from a lot of folks. This thing happened, but you see different levels of paint, primer, and windows taped over. We're getting there. We're really excited to move in, get everything finalized. We're running the brass operation now. We're going to move the ammunition in here probably in another 3 or 4 weeks. We'll see how things go. But it's a great facility, great people. Redmond has a really strong, good workforce. So we're excited. Now, there's so many people we'd like to thank, and we don't have time to thank them all, but we really want to make sure we thank George Endicott, the mayor of Redmond, for helping us out. George has been tremendous. He's a great guy. John Stark at Ready, all his team, everybody helped us out, and we just appreciate it so much. We're Central Oregonians. We're Central Oregonians for the long pull.
Well, those of you who know the Noslers, just salt of the earth type people, great to have them here and with roots, deep roots here in Central Oregon. With so many cool young companies, it was hard to choose this next one to feature. SnoPlanks is a classic example, however, about what happens when innovation, mentorship, and money come together for entrepreneurs. Here's their story.
My name is Ryan Holmes. I am one of the co-founders of SnoPlanks.
My name is James Nichol. I'm the co-founder of SnoPlanks, and we're a snowboard and ski company based out of Bend, Oregon. We manufacture bamboo snowboards that are geared toward powder riding. They're mostly powder specific. We have edged and edgeless boards. We started in 2012, and we've just slowly and organically grown locally. And this year we're looking to almost double our sales. We had a big year last year and a lot of things happened, and so we're just gearing up for 2016.
Yeah, I think one of the biggest things that we're most proud of SnoPlanks is being a company that's based here in Bend, Oregon. I think we're very proud of our roots being here in Bend, Oregon. You know, originating this company with the inspiration of Bend and the entrepreneurial spirit. So it's great to be part of Bend and represent this town and represent that entrepreneurial spirit out there. So we've had a pretty awesome journey. We literally started this company, and the idea of SnoPlanks came from a chairlift ride several years ago on a powder day. It's pretty cool to see, you know, an idea of where we're at today with our products, you know, stem from just a simple chairlift ride. But James and I decided we wanted to create something different. We wanted to try to figure out a way to introduce our passion of skiing and snowboarding to this surfing concept of the powder surfing, and to be able to ride powder in a little bit different way.
Yeah, and I think, you know, being in Bend, Oregon, and having it be a mountain town, and having no ski and snowboard company here, it was kind of like just really good timing for us. You know, I mean, we came into this with an idea that was different than anything else that's being done right now in the industry, and it's kind of more of a craft concept, and this is a very craft-centric town at the base of a beautiful range of mountains, and we were able to capitalize on that.
So, having been to a few different pub talks on various topics in my couple years here in Bend, I became introduced to EDCO, you know, through the pub talk process, but it was really when we got introduced to the Bend Outdoor Works, or BOW as it's known here in town, is where we really saw things accelerate for us. I think for us, BOW introduced us to this incredible ecosystem of resources and just incredible individuals and organizations out there that are really driven to help a company like SnoPlanks was, which was an amazing product. They're very passionate owners wanting to go out there and make a name for it in Bend, Oregon, but how do we get started and where do we go? And I think being part of the Bend Outdoor Works and getting us introduced to that ecosystem of EDCO really catapulted us from over the last year.
So it's, you know, really been incredible to be brought into this entrepreneurial community and see the spirit that people have to start new businesses here in Central Oregon. It's something that we really weren't familiar with until we were brought into this circle, and you know, through BBC, through everything that we've gone through with EDCO as a company and Bend Outdoor Works, we've been able to really rub elbows with people that have given us great feedback on starting a business. and that's invaluable information. The feedback that we've gotten has directly gone to better than SnoPlanks. And so, you know, although pub talks and BBC and everything were great experiences, it's really this community that we're in now that is the biggest win for us, because we're able to have resources that we were never able to have before.
Helping grow our own local employers is really the foundation of what EDCO does in its business development work. Here's a great story about how Metabolic Maintenance, a long-standing bioscience company, has continued to grow in the small community of Sisters.
I'm Ed Fitzgerald, CEO, founder of Metabolic Maintenance Products. So what we do is we make nutritional supplements, vitamins, minerals, amino acids, herbs, drink mixes. We have about 150 products. Everything we sell is either powder or capsules. We don't do any tablets. So everything that's in our capsules, there's not any cellulose, there's not any magsterate. Everything is active ingredients. And we pioneered that concept. And there are a couple other companies now that do that, but it just made sense to me. Why do you want, in the vegetarian capsules, why do you want anything other than active ingredients in your products? When product comes in the door, we have a number of tests we run on. Before we can ever put it into play, we pull samples from everything that comes in the door. We'll sample on each product, we run micros, we run heavy metals, we run identity testing. Once it's blended, we either put it in powder form, which we have a handful of products that are that, or we encapsulate it and put it into capsule form. And we pull it, we send it out again for testing. So there's a lot of testing, both initially in process and finished testing that goes on with each product. So we bring it in to this room that we're in the bottling room, and we bottle it up and label it up and send it out the door. So, and we ship hundreds and hundreds of packages every day. So we've been in business 32 years in March. We've been in Sisters 21 to 22 years. When we moved up here, we moved with 5 employees. We now have 38 at this facility, 8 at the Pine Street facility. Total square footage of both facilities is about 50,000 square feet. Average length of time of our employees is 12 years. People like to live here. And 75% of our employees live in Sisters, which is pretty cool. A lot of them get to walk to work. So many of them walk to work, which is also cool. More than Metabolic, it's just Sisters is a very cool place to be and to live and to get to know each other. Real homey feel. We looked at 3 different locations. When we scouted out actually 25 cities, we ended up with 3 in the Northwest: Sequim, Washington, Hood River, Oregon, and Bend, Central Oregon, which ended up being Sisters. So EDCO helped with the financing, really. I mean, they introduced me to the Oregon Economic Development Department, and they helped me with local bank financing. Without the financing, you know, we couldn't have made it. We couldn't have put it together. And back when we started, there was no enterprise zone in Sisters. But since they have begun the enterprise zone, it's tremendously helpful to be able to tap into those resources. We moved from the Pine Street facility into this facility about 9 months ago. We couldn't grow in that facility because it was 18,000 square feet. This facility is 32, and I thought about selling the Pine Street facility, but we've been at a such rapid growth, 20% year over year, I don't think we can sustain that. But still, it makes me want to hold on to the other building, because we will finish phase 2 expansion, the last 5,000 square feet, in the next 60 days. But if we continue to grow, we're going to need both facilities. I mean, it's kind of crazy. Who would have thunk?
Okay, so be honest. How many of you knew that Metabolic Maintenance was in Sisters? That's not bad. That's pretty good. You're a pretty educated group. Well, thanks for sharing those videos with us. And really want to thank Benham Digital. These are the first time I've actually seen these guys are working on the fly. There are a couple high school students actually that do these videos. They came last time, and so I really want to thank Reese Marshall and Chris Pleasance who helped put this together in between classes. And now it gives me great pleasure to introduce our longtime returning title sponsor, OSU Cascades, and Vice President Becky Johnson. Becky deserves a long introduction, but I know her, and I know that she wouldn't want that, wouldn't appreciate that. So I'll keep it short and current. As the 2015 Bend Chamber of Commerce Woman of the Year, she passed the baton to Mo Carrick last night, and I think that pretty much says a lot. So again, thank you, Becky and OSU, for sponsoring this year's luncheon.
Thanks so much, Roger, and OSU Cascades is always really proud to be a sponsor of EDCO, and really we're a partner because we have so many goals in common between OSU Cascades and EDCO. While I give my very brief remarks today, I thought it might be interesting to show a time-lapse video of the construction of our new campus. For those of you who don't drive by on a regular basis, it's pretty amazing how fast everything has gone up. And we're really excited about the opening of the new campus this fall, and we're really grateful for the support from the business community. It's really made a huge difference for us. I hope you'll all come and help us celebrate the opening in September. So this video is going to be in the background. It's either going to be mesmerizing or it's going to make you carsick. If you start getting dizzy, you'll just have to look at me instead. So in the beginning, you'll see a lot of earth moving. I think they moved the same dirt about 5 times before starting the construction. This is the site where the residence hall will be built, and in a minute, you'll see a split screen that'll show the academic building on the left. And after that, you'll see what Central Oregon winter weather does to a construction site. So while you're watching Central Oregon's university being built, I want to talk about why OSU Cascades is so supportive of EDCO. I believe our missions are linked in at least 4 ways. First, as you've already seen, EDCO recruits new businesses to Central Oregon and supports the growth of existing businesses. We provide the skilled workers for those businesses. We make a point to meet with EDCO and other business leaders to identify the new degrees that are needed to support our local businesses. That type of collaboration led to the development about 4 years ago of our energy systems engineering degree. And this year we launched our computer science degree based on an express need for software developers that we heard from EDCO and local businesses. We're now discussing possible new degrees in mechanical engineering and bioscience to support these growing sectors in Central Oregon. Second, EDCO supports entrepreneurs and startups, and OSU Cascades teaches students to be entrepreneurs. We're also developing an innovation center for entrepreneurs that will bring together students, faculty, and startups. Students will learn what it takes to start a business, and startup companies will have access to talent and resources to help get them launched. We're really grateful to the Governor's Regional Solutions Program that is providing the funds to get the Innovation Center off the ground. Third, EDCO supports industries that rely on innovation, research, and development. And OSU Cascades has incredibly creative and talented faculty who are engaged in research and can partner with local industry. Faculty's research can also directly result in new products that can spin out into new local companies. This has already happened with Chris Hagen's research on natural gas engines at OSU Cascades and the resulting spin-out company, Onboard Dynamics. And fourth, EDCO supports a strong, diversified, and sustainable economy. And it's well known that universities in general are a stabilizing force for local economies. OSU Cascades will do the same for Central Oregon. With good-paying jobs and enrollment that swells when the private economy is shrinking, OSU Cascades can help combat the boom and bust cycle that has plagued Central Oregon. This synergy between higher education and economic development is shown in city after city in the United States. In fact, our speaker today is the author of a study of the best-performing cities, and Bend is number 8 on the small city list. What all the other small cities on the list have in common is they are all home to at least 1 4-year university. Now with OSU Cascades' expansion to a 4-year university, Bend can join these other cities, and maybe in a couple of years, we'll be number 1 on that list. How are we doing? Have we built the campus. So let's hear directly from the author of that study today. Manoli Ratnatunga is an associate director and research economist at the Milken Institute, focused on regional economic development and regional competitiveness. Before joining the Institute, she worked for 8 years at the Allegheny Conference on Community Development, a regional economic development organization focused on improving the competitiveness and quality of life in the Pittsburgh region. At the Allegheny Conference, Manoli focused her research on energy policy, transportation and infrastructure funding, and state tax competitiveness, working with civic and business leaders to help key decision makers make better policy choices. She also led the economic impact study practice, managing the production of research reports that captured the importance of strategic industries and projects to the Pennsylvania economy. Manoli has a master's degree in public policy and management from Carnegie Mellon University and a bachelor's degree in philosophy and economics from the London School of Economics. Please join me in giving a warm Central Oregon welcome to Manoli Ratnatunga.
Thank you very much. Set up my timer so that I try and stay on schedule. So, thank you for inviting me to join you to talk about our Best Performing Cities Index and to talk about what that might mean for the Central Oregon economy. Today I'll give you a bit of background on our Best Performing Cities Index. I'll talk about the results that we found in our 2015 report, and then we'll focus in on Central Oregon and what we can learn from your metro's ranking. A little bit of background for you. So I'm an economist at the Milken Institute, and I lead our regional economics practice. And for those of you who are unfamiliar with the Milken Institute, we're an independent, nonprofit, nonpartisan economic think tank based in Santa Monica, California, with offices in Washington, D.C., London, and Singapore. We undertake independent research and convene decision makers to try and pursue our mission of widening access to capital, enhancing health, and creating jobs, and developing human capital. We have an ambitious research agenda that focuses on the issues that matter in a complex and interconnected global economy. And because of our mission, we place a strong emphasis on capital markets, health, and job creation in our research. We publish reports that inform and create that inform decision makers, and also create interactive sites that aim to make our data accessible and easy to understand. As part of our research into job creation and human capital, we've published a series of reports that evaluate the cities where jobs are being created and sustained in economies across the U.S. Our Best Performing Cities report was first published in Forbes magazine in 1999, and we're currently on our 16th edition of the index. As you can see from the cover of our 2015 index, which we released in December, the San Jose and San Francisco area were doing very well. So two Bay Area cities topped our list, thanks to developments in the tech industry. And the goal is to provide businesses and civic leaders like yourselves an understanding not just of how your economy is doing, because you probably have a better sense than I do about how the Central Oregon economy is doing, but how it compares to other cities. Could you be doing better? Sense when things are going well, but you don't know how much better you could be doing. We released, as I mentioned, our 2015 report in December at our California Summit in Los Angeles. And we had an event in January in San Jose with the Mayor Sam Liccardo, who talked about his efforts in San Jose to build an innovation economy and expand the economic linkages across the Bay Area. And if I cover some of this material too fast, or if you're interested in finding out how cities have done in the past, you can find lots of information on our website, which is www.best-cities.org. And the site allows you to compare different cities against each other, and also to access decades worth of data and get a free copy of the report and previous editions. You can also play around with this fun map, which I'll return to later, that summarizes the results from our study. So each year we rank the 200 largest metro populations by, we rank the top metro cities by population. And we also have a companion index that looks at the 201 small metros. And this is the results from the large cities list. You can see that technology was a driving force in a lot of these economies. However, these metros also possessed a variety of other positive traits that help explain their success. Several metros are in dense urban areas, but they have an innovation advantage because of the clustering of technology and talent that helps them overcome what might be a more restrictive regulatory environment or a punitive, some might argue it's punitive, tax environment, because they have this entrepreneurial ecosystem that they've managed to build up. So how do we come up with our rankings? Well, it's all outcomes-based, so it's not based on how important one organization might find crime rates to quality of life, or we don't look at cost of housing or anything like that. We look at jobs, we look at wages, and then we look at the growth, diversity, and concentration of your high-tech industry. The aim is to capture job growth because that demonstrates how vital your community is. We also look at wage and salary growth because that captures the quality of the jobs that are being made. And then the technology measures help us understand how invested you are in the knowledge economy. We look at a variety of one-year measures, five-year measures, and we have one small momentum index that tries to capture what's happened in the most recent 12 months because, of course, national data always lags by a fair amount when you're trying to look across so many different economies. But the idea is to try and capture both performance in the most recent year and performance across the business cycle. On our 2015 index, San Jose, Sunnyvale, Santa Clara was back at number one, a position it last held in 2012. The metro is an example of how an innovation-fueled ecosystem can overcome high costs of doing business and a restrictive regulatory environment. It had the highest job growth in the nation in 2014, for metros with population over a million people. High-tech hardware continues to play a prominent role in the metro's success, and it contributed to the rise of 25% since the recovery in manufacturing jobs. So there were 25% more manufacturing jobs since the beginning of the recovery from the recession. And they also have this amazing innovation and entrepreneurial ecosystem. So there were 17,000 patent registrations in 2014. They had 8,600 startups and 23 IPOs in 2014. They had $9.8 billion worth of venture capital investments in 2014, which was the highest since the year 2000. Cities like San Jose and closely ranked San Francisco have seen wage growth above the national average, and that's contributed to their top performance. The San Jose Metro Division ranked fourth and second for on 1 and 5 year wage growth, and average annual earnings there were $116,000 as opposed to $61,500 being the average for the nation as a whole. The high-tech service sector has been a primary source of growth in the region as well. Most of these jobs in the creative and scientific sector fall within the professional scientific and technical services, and you can see here how jobs have increased in those in that industry more than in the nation as a whole. Google and Apple seem to be in a competition to see who can absorb the most office space, and that's fueling a lot of construction. You're seeing, I think it was something like 6 million square feet of office space under development in the third quarter of 2015. San Francisco, Redwood City, South San Francisco was ranked second this year on our index. It remains one of the most vibrant metros in the region, and its tech-fueled growth is drawing young knowledge workers from around the country and around the world. In terms of job growth, San Francisco ranked sixth in 2014 and fifth over the 5 years between 2009 and 2014. For a dense urban area, ranking fifth on job growth across all metros, when it's compared, it's competing with metros that don't have the same kinds of space constraints, is really an unrivaled accomplishment. Provo Orem, Utah was at number three. It stayed steady between 2014 and 2015, and its low taxes and favorable business climate overall provide an advantage over other tech sectors like San Jose and San Francisco. It's an example of how a strong university can really help support growth. And the business climate is creating fertile ground for indigenous growth of companies, as well as attracting expansions from companies headquartered elsewhere. The high wage growth associated with the technology jobs is having large spillover effects in their economy. At number four, Austin is the most consistent top five finisher on our Best Performing Cities Index. Its economic growth is more stable than most of the other metros that we've looked at, especially tech sectors. And it's from a combination of factors that are somewhat unique to Austin. They're a place people want to move to, it's a magnet for skilled workers, it's a university town, it's a state capital. For a while, it was a state capital of an energy, during an energy boom, which always helped. But it also has an aggressive and focused business development strategy. And not all of these factors are reproducible in every metro, but there are certainly aspects of their strategy that may work for you here. And tech is important to the Austin economy. It has the ninth highest concentration of technology production in the nation. Like Austin, Dallas is continuing to do well despite the drop in oil prices that has affected a lot of other Texas metros. On our 2014 index, five of the top 10 cities were in Texas. On our 2015 index, three of the top 25 were in Texas. So you can see that cities that were dependent solely on the energy industry really suffered, whereas the cities that had diversified, and Dallas certainly learned its lesson and has diversified over the last 30 years, were more resilient to this drop in oil prices. And now they're a regional financial services hub. You have regional headquarters from JPMorgan Chase, Citibank, and Bank of America there. They're also a logistics and distribution hub for Amazon and for UPS. And they also, thanks to the economic development strategy of Texas, a prime location for relocation. So they're very good at attracting other companies, companies from other states to move there. And we're a bit sour about that in Southern California because Toyota, for example, moved to Plano last year, citing the cost of doing business and the cost for their employees to live in Southern California as a reason that they moved. Raleigh, North Carolina dropped one spot to sixth place, and it's another example of how a favorable business climate can really support economic performance. Seattle's at number seven, and it climbed four spots. Much of its success can be traced to the tech sector. The region ranked second in the nation for the importance of high-tech industries to their output, up from fourth the previous year. And The city has a strong concentration in cloud computing and data storage, two sectors that have grown dramatically in recent years. Companies like HP, Amazon, Microsoft, and Google all have cloud computing operations based in the city. So Portland is at number eight on our large cities list. It climbed eight spots. And the region's educated workforce continues to attract employers who offer high-quality jobs. And technology companies are driving up demand for office space in Portland. Wages for high school workers and electricity costs both compare favorably to the Bay Area, even though they are going up. And so that makes them an attractive alternate location for companies in the Bay Area who are looking to expand somewhere more cost effectively. So here's that map that I showed you earlier. It shows the ranking of all 401 metros that we rank. Coloring them based on their performance. Red is bad, green is good. Not that informative. Here is the same map with just the 201 small metros, and it still doesn't seem that informative. But the Best Performing Cities Index does allow you to take a very high-level look at the performance of cities. So we'll zoom in a bit more and just look at the top 50 metros. And you can see here that there are many different paths to success. It's not that the cities that are doing well are all clustered around the Bay Area, although there are a number of those. But around the country, you can see that there are cities that are doing well. But if we look at the bottom 50 cities, you can see a clearer geographic message there, that cities, smaller cities in the east, in the south, and in the Midwest are not doing as well. And in fact, the West Coast looks remarkably unscarred. And part of that is because states like Oregon entered the recovery a little bit later than some of the cities further east. And so you had more ground to make up in the time that we were evaluating, and so performed better on some of our growth measures. But it's also that you're benefiting from the ripple effects of the tech growth on the West Coast in cities like Portland, Seattle, and in the Bay Area. And that sort of those ripple effects come through tourism spending, for example, here in Bend. So let's look at the results on our companion index that measures the performance of smaller cities. The 2015 index covers 201 small cities. That's up from 179 because the census, as part of the census, they redefined the cities that we should evaluate, and so we expanded our list. Four of the top 10 metros from 2014 reclaimed spots in the top tier, including our number one, Fargo, North Dakota, which held on to the top spot. Fargo's diverse economy, along with its ability to capitalize on North Dakota's historic oil boom, has been key to its recent success. The oil boom benefited a number of industries in Fargo, including construction and transportation, and it generated a lot of infrastructure projects. But the metro has consistently done well on our index. It only broke into the top 10 in 2009, but its lowest rank in more than a decade was 36th. So it's a very consistent performer. And we would expect that although it will probably drop as the benefits from the oil exploration drops off, they won't be hit as hard as some of the smaller communities we saw in states like Pennsylvania, where there was a more severe drop. Like Fargo, Bismarck, North Dakota enjoyed increased economic activity from the exploration of the Bakken Shale during the boom years. The metro's more stable government and healthcare sectors helped keep the economy afloat. And as a capital city, Bismarck has a high concentration of employment in local and state government. Ames, Iowa, which is home to Iowa State University and a number of national laboratories, climbed 11 spots to rank third on our 2015 Small Cities Index. Ames's competitive business climate and its ability to draw from a larger than average talent pool has been key to its success. Now let's focus in on the Central Oregon region's economy and how it performed. As you can see here on our 2015 Best Performing Cities Index, Central Oregon climbed 38 spots to finish in eighth place. You finished third amongst small metros on one-year job growth. That was 4% more than the national average during that period. And growth in tourism has been a key driver of performance. There was a question about, you know, what does this 38-point jump mean? And as you can see, there's a fair amount of movement on our small cities list from year to year. That's partly why we have two separate lists. Smaller economies can experience larger percentage shifts, for example, from one large plant opening or closing. And the smallest regions on the list that we evaluate have a population of 55,000 people. So you can see how a new plant of 500 people would be a significant change there. If I'd expanded the table, Central Oregon's 38-point jump would have come in at 23rd. So it's a dramatic but not atypical move. Our job and wage growth metrics are economy-wide, so how many more jobs were there, independent of industry, how much more money did people earn in total across the whole economy. But we also consider a number of factors that are focused specifically on the high-tech industries. So we'll look at that in more detail. Some of the metros that had a high growth rate, like you did in over the 5 years between 2009 and 2014, had a high growth rate because they were growing from a very small base. So going from 10 to 20 employees in a particular industry might make for a great growth rate, but that doesn't actually mean that it's an important part of your economy. That's not the case here. You also rank 12th for the level of concentration of the high-tech industry in your community. So that means that there were 11 regions in the country out of the 200 who had where high-tech industry output was a larger share of their region's output than it was here. So it's really an important part of your economy. And it's also relatively diverse, and we'll go into that a bit more. We found that the high-tech industries are as important to the Central Oregon economy as it is to the nation as a whole. That might not sound so impressive, and especially if you compare it to the top three metros on our large cities list, which are all tech hubs. But if you compare it to the average for large metros that we looked at, it's about typical. And if we look at the small cities, which are a better peer group for Central Oregon, you can see that you're not just outperforming the average for small cities, which is about half, it would be typical to have about half as much concentration as the national economy, but you're also outperforming the top three cities overall on our small cities index. Your startup scene, and combined with things like your data centers and your med tech and so on, is all representing a significant part of your economy. To evaluate the diversity of a city's high-tech sector, we look at how many of the 19 industries that we categorize as being high-tech are more important to the local economy than they are to the national economy. So we take this aggregate measure that we looked at across all of the 19 together to look at the concentration initially. Now we're looking individually at these 19 industries. And you can see that there are six where Central Oregon is more concentrated in those industries than the nation is as a whole. That placed you at fourth amongst the small cities that we evaluated. And you can see that you've consistently performed pretty well in the last 6 years, except for there were 2 years where it looks like things got a lot worse. And I went and looked into the data, and actually nothing changed here. The six industries that you were concentrated in then, but because it's a relative index, some cities gained and then apparently lost concentration in some of these industries, and then dropped that pushed you down the rankings. So it's not really something to worry about specifically, except there was growth going on that you didn't manage to get hold of. You can also see that most of the high-tech sectors that you're more concentrated in than the national economy fall within computer and electronic product manufacturing. And sometimes that's a concern, but because of the types of products that you make, because they are for different markets and they're different products, it is relatively diverse. And you should be less vulnerable to an industry shock than some of the other economies that we've looked at. And if we look at other major metros in Oregon, I'll just skim over this. I've just highlighted some of the good performance, so top 20 finishes, I think, for Oregon metros in the high-tech factors that we looked at. And you can see most of them have some strength in the high-tech sector. And this can sort of help designate Oregon as a high-tech state. We've certainly seen that in Colorado, that people who are thinking about starting up a business, that they'll consider a state that they perceive to be a place where people go to start businesses. So that might be promising. But drawing on our work ranking the best performing cities, as well as other work that we do looking at state technology and science performance and the links between educational attainment of a population and their economic growth, we believe that there is a strong incentive to develop your workforce. You need people with flexible skills to help cities adapt to economic shocks and to adapt to technological change. For example, in California, where we're based, we're seeing that in the agriculture sector, where previously you didn't need very many skills to be able to work in the sector. And now you need to be able to read monitoring equipment. You might need to know how to fly a drone. You know, there are many higher requirements, and the employers in the agriculture section are telling us that they're having trouble finding and recruiting talented workers. While we saw that Oregon cities did relatively well on our high-tech indicators, our research that we've done into the investments that are made into technology and science, human capital, places Oregon in about the middle of the pack. So there's certainly growth there. There are policies that you could improve there. And while we know that, you know, a higher quality of life like you have here can attract educated migrants from elsewhere, it's also important to develop your local community. As your tech sector expands, finding talent with the right skills could become more challenging, and an increasing concern for businesses. Business climate is obviously an important consideration when businesses are expanding or starting up, but increasingly businesses are telling us that what keeps them up at night is finding the right people. And a region that does a good job of connecting to its higher educational institutions, taking business needs and translating them well to the training that they provide in their higher education institutions are going to be attractive for businesses that are looking to relocate or to expand. And it also helps foster innovation and entrepreneurship, another thing that is very important. And we've seen that, you know, if you look at the San Francisco and San Jose area, they're performing very well despite their business climate. So workforce really can be an important factor. And the partnerships building on the partnerships that you already have with CSU Cascades and with the community college is key to continuing the growth here. Reports like these are fun to write because I get to learn about lots of different cities around the country and what makes them tick. But at the Milken Institute, what we really want to do is help decision makers make better choices for their communities to create prosperity. And so what I want you to take away from this presentation is that you're doing well economically, you have a meaningful tech sector that you're developing well, and you're benefiting from growth that's happening in major West Coast urban centers in the tech sector. And so that's, to some extent, a little bit of a concern, because a downturn in the tech sector overall may have ripple effects in your economy. So diversifying the industries that you have here, growing the ones that need a push, so that you have a broader set of industries here, and really working on the talent is something that we would encourage you to do. Not everyone wants to live in an overpriced and congested West Coast city. And I say this as someone who spends 3 hours commuting to and from work every day. And so, you know, finding the people who want to work, start, and grow here, I think, is what will really help you prosper. So thank you very much for your time.
We're going to go ahead and open up some questions. So before we move on to our next speaker, but Manoli, thanks so much. I could listen to what your research has to deliver, all afternoon long. So we'll go ahead and take some questions from the audience. I'm sure there's got to be some out there about this. So we'll try to get your hands as they come up. So anybody start us off? Representative Bueller.
Sure. So, well, we do consider some high-tech manufacturing sectors. It's not just high-tech service sectors. The question was, why do we focus on the high-tech sector? Most of our measures, the bulk of the weight of our index, looks at job growth and wage growth across the whole economy. But we think that the high-tech sectors demonstrate how well you're integrated into the knowledge economy. And going forward, we see that as being an area that's going to grow. And so cities that have strength there, we see as being ones that are primed to perform well in the long term.
Other questions?
Mm-hmm. Oh, go ahead. Doug. When you look at the highest performing cities on the large cities, They're in the Bay Area.
Mm-hmm.
You said the average wage was about $120,000?
$116,000.
For someone who earns $116,000, if that's the family income, they cannot afford housing within that area. You've talked about a three-hour commute in Southern California.
Yep.
Having children who live in San Jose, that's a reality for them. They cannot afford housing, even with that level of income. So as we look, and as you look at high-performing cities, and as you look at the future of Central Oregon and the increased cost of housing, what would you predict our future to be in that regard?
Well, I think it's in your hands. One of the things that we saw when we launched our report in 2014 in San Francisco, when they were number one, was the main thing that Mayor Lee wanted to talk about was all of the new housing that he was trying to get started. So he was very aware of the fact that especially for the people who aren't earning $116,000. I mean, it's a very difficult place to be, to have your city suddenly be more and more expensive. And partly it's, are you putting enough units of housing into place? And are you putting them in the right places so that people aren't having to commute for a long time, that you have dense development in the right places, and then maintaining the character of other parts of the city. So not everyone wants to live in a high-rise, and but people who do should have the choice to do that, and you want to maintain the rural part of your community as well. And so planning wisely for growth, I think, is vital.
Time for one or two more questions. John?
Since tourism is big in Central Oregon, you didn't mention that. How does that play into your... the area here?
Well, I think that a lot of the job growth that we saw in the most recent year in 2014 was due to tourism. So it's definitely a large part of how you did on the two most important, or two of the most important indicators that we consider.
So when you're ranking small municipalities and you're looking at incentives, do you weigh some of the local incentives in your studies?
No, we actually don't look at any types of things that people, any strategies that people might use to try and improve their cities. We just look at how did it work or not. And so for a long time, you could see it in the Texas metros that it was working for them, and maybe it's not working as well anymore. But no, it's not something that we consider in our primary sources.
Hello, my name is Casey Rhodes. I'm on the Mid-City Council, and Councilor Jadowski and I spend a lot of time trying to convince our colleagues that the supply of housing does in fact affect its price. But try as we might, they insist it does not because they are stalwart supporters of Oregon's land use system.
Mm-hmm.
Since you're an economist, can you give me some nuggets I can take to them that would help us make the case that perhaps more units might actually result in more housing, which could affect its price?
Well, I mean, we have trouble convincing people in Los Angeles that that's a factor, so I think that's universal. There's a concern, at least, I don't know how things work here, but certainly in Los Angeles, we've seen that there's a concern that the building that is happening is only happening at the high end. And so it's not just building more units, it's building units at a range of affordability. For a different a range of incomes, and so I think all of that is important. But no, I don't have a killer argument for you. I apologize.
Okay, maybe one more question.
Was there, you had shown the cities who were doing poorly and identified kind of the southeast city.
Mm-hmm.
About those cities that are growing,
that will be too loud. Those cities that are growing, is there a correlation to infrastructure, to universities, that type of thing, that those cities that are doing poorly have failed to maintain, as versus the cities that are doing really well and they are maintaining that sense of infrastructure?
Sometimes it's luck, right? If you were very heavily invested in natural gas exploration, you saw huge amounts of investment, and now there's overcapacity, so it's going to be a long time till anyone adds any new jobs in that field. In some cases, it's a stagnant economy, so it's very stable, and those metros may have done very well during the recession when people who had overbuilt in their communities saw a construction collapse, and all of a sudden just slow and steady boosted you to the top of the rankings. And now they're now when everyone's growing and recovering those jobs, they fall down. So it's not necessarily the case that they've done something wrong to drop in the rankings. And when I talk to reporters from those cities, I try and emphasize that. But yes, it is the case that there is growth happening elsewhere in the economy, and they're not party to that. They're doing some things. They're not as competitive at the moment as some of these other communities.
Well, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'm running away.
Well, thanks again. Manoli is actually off for that flight. Maybe that's a little bit shorter commute than she has daily to get back to L.A. on that direct service to L.A. from Redmond. So now I'd like to introduce Evan Dickens. He's a CPA, shareholder, and partner with Jones & Ross CPAs, which is also a longtime keynote sponsor of this event. And if I were smart, I'd ask Evan to MC this luncheon because he's natural on stage and with the microphone. So Evan, come on up and take us away.
Nothing can go wrong with that introduction. Thanks, Roger. Good afternoon, everyone. I want to thank you very much for attending this tremendous event. My name is Evan Dickens. I'm a CPA and partner in the Central Oregon office of Jones & Roth CPAs and Business Advisors. I want to say what a pleasure it is to be partnering with EDCO to be the keynote sponsor here for the third year in a row. Also the third consecutive year of an attendance record. Coincidence? I don't know. Maybe. EDCO is a great organization that has made a significant positive impact in the economic strength of this great region that we live in. And Jones & Roth's focus on small business services is a perfect fit with EDCO's ongoing support of this great business and entrepreneurial ecosystem. I really want to thank Roger Lee, Aaron Riley, the entire EDCO staff for cultivating this event into something we're really proud to be associated with. For the first time ever, we're sharing lunch today with more than 600 people in this room. So that's a tremendous milestone. I have one request as a sponsor. We've had a lot of exciting news about air service over the years at this luncheon. Perhaps next year we'll have an announcement of charter air service to where we parked our cars, because that could be very useful for some of us, I think. I also, one more thing, I want to thank OSU Cascades for being a tremendous positive influence in our community. Among the other things that they've done, they've added a four-year accounting program, which is in its third year. Jones & Roth has just hired its first OSU Cascades accounting intern for this summer. So we're all in this together. We all share in each other's success, and I really appreciate that, Becky. Just briefly about Jones & Roth, if I go more than a minute, Matt, I want you to hit me with that siren, please. Jones & Roth has been committing substantial resources to developing our startup and emerging company service area, focusing on launch and growth stage companies and entrepreneurs, and providing a package of services to assist growing companies as they seek funding and seek to execute on their mission. We're also proud to be sponsors and accounting supporters of the Cascade Angels Fund, the Bend Venture Conference, Rain, Oregon, many other parts of this ecosystem. And of course, this time of year, we're very focused on providing tax preparation services to businesses and individuals of all sizes. I see many clients, many friends, some clients who are friends, that does happen occasionally, and hopefully quite a few future clients in this audience today, and I thank you all for your support of our firm. Briefly want to recognize my colleagues, Robert Adrian, our Director of Client Services, and Brian Newton, my partner. He's the CPA you should talk to if you like your CPAs to wear ties. I'm not that guy. It is now my distinct pleasure to introduce to you from three time zones away our second keynote speaker, Nicole Kading. Nicole is an economist with the Center for State Tax Policy at the Tax Foundation in Washington, D.C. Previously, Nicole was a budget analyst for the Cato Institute, focused on federal and state fiscal policy, and the state policy manager for Americans for Prosperity Foundation, where she oversaw the policy activities of their 34 state chapters. Nicole's work has been featured in the Washington Post, the Chicago Tribune, National Public Radio, Huffington Post, National Review Online, and numerous other national, state, and local publications. She graduated from DePaul University with a master's degree in economics and policy analysis and completed her undergraduate studies at Miami University, majoring in finance and political science. She also participated in the year-long Koch Associate Program and was a National Review Institute Washington fellow. Nicole lives in Washington, D.C. with her husband and two children. I'm hopeful she's going to stay long enough to see some of the actual Central Oregon weather that we're really proud of, because she's been on the other side of the mountains all week. But we're so pleased to have someone with her expertise here. Will you please join me in providing a Central Oregon welcome to Nicole Kading?
Thank you. Thank you for that warm introduction, Evan. Thank you, Roger and Aaron and the entire EDCO staff for having me. I'm going to apologize. I have been on a speaking tour across the Northwest all week, and my voice is paying for it. So hopefully my gentleman in the back can make sure that the mic is high enough that you all can hear me. So I'm here to talk about Oregon's tax climate. What I want to do is I want to highlight what you all do well here. I want to highlight what you don't do so well here, and then talk about what I see as a very large threat to your current tax structure coming in the fall. Before we get started laying out an agenda for our talk, the first is we're going to talk about what are the keys to understanding a state's tax policy. Like any policy area, it's a complicated mess. And so if we look at one specific instance of a state's tax code or tax climate, it tells us something, but it doesn't give us a full picture. So we're going to talk about what are the various measures we can use to talk about a state's tax climate and run through those. Those are things like your business tax climate index, which I will talk about, tax burdens, which has to do with the amount of income that goes towards paying taxes every year. Tax collections, which is a measure of how much revenue does a state or a locality bring in revenue, and then Initiative Petition 28. So first, before we get started, an introduction to who the Tax Foundation is. The Tax Foundation was founded in 1937. We are almost 80 years old, making us one of the oldest think tanks not only in the country, but the nation's leading voice on independent tax policy research. We have published facts and figures since 1941, and we publish what's called Tax Freedom Day every year. This is a measure of how much or how long does an individual need to work every year to pay their share of taxes. Here in Oregon, for instance, you all have to work until April 14th every year to pay your share of federal, state, and local taxes. So until tax day on April 15th, you have not actually made a salary for the year. Very depressing, I know. So first, we're going to talk about what are the keys to understanding state tax policy. Like I said, looking at one measure specifically doesn't give us a good idea, doesn't give us a full picture. We like to think about tax policy as consisting in four separate buckets. The first is tax burdens. Like I said, that's the amount of income that goes towards paying taxes every year. We look at tax collections, the amount that a state or a locality collects in revenue from various sources. We can talk about tax rates. What is the actual rate that you charge on corporate income taxes or individual income taxes or estate taxes, et cetera? And then finally, tax structures. So how do you collect the taxes that you have? Do you make it easy to comply? Do you make it difficult to comply? Do you make it easy to understand or complicated? Do you need to hire someone like Evan to help you do your taxes, or is it a bit simpler than that? So the first I'm going to talk about is Oregon's business tax climate. This is our measure of a tax code structure. You will find on your table one copy of the report that you all can share. If you want to find look at it in more detail after the talk or when you go back to your offices, it is available on our website. So what do? We look at 100 measures of a state's tax code. We are looking at not only what are the rates that you charge on corporate income and individual income and on sales taxes. You all, of course, don't have a sales tax. We're also looking at things like, do you use the federal code as the basis of your state code, which makes things a bit easier to comply with taxes? Do you have certain types of net operating loss carry forwards or carry backs, which we'll talk a little bit about as well? Do you have 100 different measures, right? We're looking at a variety of different things. And overall, Oregon scores fairly well in our index. You are, for the 2016 index, ranked 11th nationally. So this means you had the 11th best business tax climate in the country. Now, talking to many of you while I've been here, that is not the sense that I got. And I will agree with you that that's probably a bit overstated. And that's because of the fact that you all don't have a sales tax, and we'll talk about this a bit more. But first, I wanted you to see the results across the country. Hopefully that is big enough that you can see it. But you all are 11th, your neighbors to the north, Washington, are 12th. Your neighbors to the south, California, are 48th. There are the outliers here. And to make it a bit easier, the states that are in blue are the 10 best states, and the states that are in orange are the 10 worst states. So I'll pause here and let you get a sense of where things are. And you'll notice, unlike some of the maps that Manoli was showing, there doesn't really seem to be a geographic component here. It's not that all of the states are concentrated in one area of the country and all of the bad states are in another. There does seem to be some geographic diversity. But in our index, we actually look at five different types of taxes. We look at corporate taxes, we look at individual taxes, we look at sales taxes, we look at unemployment taxes, and we look at property taxes. So you'll notice that, again, you rank very, very high for your sales tax because you don't have one. That's really what's driving your score upward. You also rank fairly highly on property taxes, and that's largely because of the constitutional caps that you all have here, what measure 5 and 50, I believe you all refer to them as. So those two are boosting your scores. But if you look particularly in the corporate income tax component or the individual income tax component, you're not scoring as well. You're in the bottom third of states on corporate income tax, and you're in the bottom third for individual income taxes. So what do you do well? Like I said, you have no sales tax. That's what's really driving your score. You do some things well in those indices that you are struggling with as well. So you have no marriage penalty here in Oregon. This is a good thing. A marriage penalty is this idea that a couple should not pay more in taxes just because they are married than if they filed as two single individuals. You do not have one. This is good. The federal government does have a marriage penalty. Many states have a marriage penalty. So you are doing things right in that instance. The second is you actually inflation adjust your tax brackets every year. So what does this mean? We have in Oregon and many other states, you have several different tax rates, and you have certain bands of income that are taxed at these various rates. And ideally, what should be happening is that amount of income that's taxed at a specific rate, that bracket should increase slightly every year in relation to inflation. Because your wages are also increasing in relation to inflation, and we don't want you to pay more in taxes just because you kept up with inflation. So you all do this correctly. And it seems like it'd make a very small difference year to year, and frankly it does. If we're talking about a 2 or 3% inflation rate, these are not large tax increases. But if you don't do this correctly over time, it can become a very large problem. For instance, the state of Missouri does not inflation adjust their tax brackets. And in fact, they have not adjusted their tax bracket since the late 1920s. So Missouri has 9 tax brackets. The top marginal rate kicks in at $9,000 in income. Now, $9,000 in income in the 1920s, a bit different than today. And so what they have is they have a lot of complexity, but really a functionally a flat tax code. Because the majority of everyone's income is being taxed at that highest marginal rate, but you've got a lot of complexity, you've got this weird stair-step function. And so short-term inflation adjusting matters a little, but over a long term, it can really have impacts on individuals' taxes. You do not have a capital stock tax here in Oregon. This is good. A capital stock tax is a tax on the wealth of a corporation. These are depression-era taxes. Most states either never had them or they've gotten rid of them. There are a few states in the South, in particular, that have kept them. I believe there's 16 states that still have these types of taxes. You all don't have them. This is good. You also don't have a real estate transfer tax. This is a tax that many states have that is in addition to a property tax. So when you buy a home, you occasionally will pay a state or a locality an additional amount in taxes. You do not have that here. This is good. It makes it a bit easier to buy and sell houses here in Oregon and makes it a bit cheaper to do so as well. And then finally, you only have two brackets on your corporate income tax code. This is good. Ideally, to maximize economic growth, we want to talk about lower rates and broader bases in our tax structures. And you only have two rates, so this is a positive thing. But what don't you do well? We just talked about corporate income taxes. You only have two brackets, yet your rates are very high. So corporations in the state of Oregon pay 6.6 or 7.6% of income. The national average for states is going to be in that 5 to 6 range. So you are on the higher side. There are some states that are higher. Pennsylvania, for instance, pays 9.99% for corporations. Your individual income tax rates are also very high. You go all the way up to 9.9% on your individual code. And again, states tend to be in the 5 to 6% range. So those two rates, both individual income and corporate income, your tax rates are very, very high. And then additionally, you have an estate tax. So traditionally, individuals talk about an estate tax as being a good thing to break up dynastic wealth, right? The very, very wealthy should not be able to transfer all of their assets to their heirs. The government should be taking a small sliver out of that so that we can spread wealth around society. But what really happens is that if you are a very wealthy individual, you have a very, very large incentive to hire a team of lawyers and accountants to avoid this tax. And in fact, the very wealthy do engage this sort of approach. If you talk about Warren Buffett, all of his money is going to be transferred to the Bill Gates Foundation upon his death to avoid the taxes. Bill Gates has also done this. And in fact, if you look at the individuals who pay the individual or pay the estate tax, it's individuals like that are in this room. It's small business owners. It's family farmers. It's owners of very small manufacturing firms. It's people who don't really realize the effect of the estate tax, or perhaps they don't think that they will be affected. For instance, the federal estate tax kicks in at $5 million here in Oregon. I believe it's $1 million. And so if you're a family farmer who has a couple hundred acres of land, you might not think of being a wealthy individual, but the valuation of that land could very well throw you into that estate tax category, which then makes your heirs have to face some very tough decisions. Do they sell part of your land? Do they liquidate the business? What do they do to satisfy that payment that's due to both the state of Oregon and the federal government? So that's tax structure. Next, we're going to talk about tax burdens. So when I talk about tax burdens, what I'm referring to is the amount of income that is going to paying state and local taxes. And this goes beyond tax collections, because we as individuals not only pay taxes to our state and our locality, we also pay taxes to states and localities across the country. So you're like, but how do I do that? So really simple example. I am here in town visiting. When I picked up my rental car, I paid a sales tax on the rental car. If you decide to go down to California to take your children to Disneyland on vacation, you will be paying sales taxes in the state of California. You will pay sales taxes on your hotel, on your rental car, on the food and beverage that you consume. Those revenues would be accounted for as tax collections in the state of California. But we actually argue that doesn't give us the full picture, because really the economic decision was made here in Oregon. You decided here whether or not you could afford to take your family to California to go to Disneyland. So we try to allocate for those sorts of cross-state transactions. Other easy example to understand, let's say my home state of Indiana, many people own lake houses in Wisconsin. Fairly short drive, couple hour drive up to Wisconsin. So if you own a lake house in Wisconsin, you're paying property taxes to the state of Wisconsin or to the locality in which your lake home resides. But again, the economic decision was back in Indiana. These were factors you considered before you bought the home. And even when you remit the payments, you live in Indiana. The most extreme example is actually almost the entire budget of the state of Alaska. 80% of revenues in the state of Alaska are from severance taxes. These are taxes that are assessed on oil and natural gas extraction. So if we look at tax collections in Alaska on a per capita basis, meaning how taxes relative to their population, they're a far outlier. They are several thousand dollars per year per capita out on the extreme. But Alaska residents don't pay that tax functionally. We pay that tax. When we go put gasoline in our car, or we buy polyester fabric, which is made from petroleum, or we use natural gas to heat our homes or to cook our food. So really what's happening is that those taxes, in terms of the sales taxes with going to Disneyland or buying a vacation home or Alaska severance taxes, they're exporting them to other localities. And nationally, about 22% of taxes are collected from non-residents. So what does this mean here in Oregon? In fiscal year 2012, this is the most recent data that we have available. Unfortunately, the federal government data lags several years. I know Manoli was mentioning this as well. State local tax burden for the state of Oregon was 10.3%. That means 10.3% of all personal income generated in the state of Oregon is going to paying state and local taxes, both here in the state and out of state. And on a per capita basis, Oregonians pay about $3,000 a year to in-state localities and pay about $1,000 a year to out-of-state governments. And this is above the national average. The national average was 9.9% for this year. Now, your tax burdens have decreased slightly the last several years, but that's really mirroring a national trend. It's not because things have gotten better here in Oregon. Because we look at personal income is increasing at a faster rate currently than tax collections as we've come out of the Great Recession. But we should expect these numbers to stabilize here in probably the next year or two. So here is the results for all of the 50 states. Again, I'll pause here to let you get a better sense. But the darker green, the higher the burden. So where before in Business Tax Climate Index, 11 was good. Here, 10 is very bad. It's the 10th highest. And again, you'll notice there's not a very, very large geographic correlation that you can see, other than New York, Connecticut, and New Jersey all rank 1, 2, 3, and that's largely because you have three high-tax states that neighbor each other. So you have many residents who travel across state lines day to day. Many people in Connecticut work in New York City, meaning they're paying New York City state taxes, New York City county local taxes for income, but they're paying Connecticut property taxes, et cetera. So now we'll talk about tax collections. So we talked about tax burdens, which is accounting for these cross-border shifts, but it's also interesting to look at just where does the state of Oregon get its revenue. So these are per capita figures, and this is fiscal year 2013, which is again the most recent data that I have. You'll notice for individual income taxes, you rank very high nationally. You as a state pay a larger amount, one of the highest amounts in per capita tax collections for individual income. You're towards the lower half for corporate income. Sales, of course, doesn't apply. And total state collections, you tend to be in the middle of the pack. So looked at all these various things. These kind of give us a broad picture, right? In some ways, you're doing well. In some ways, you're not doing so well. There's definitely some areas for improvement. There are some opportunities where you also can institute some reforms, particularly in the individual and the corporate income tax codes. But now what I want to spend the second half of my presentation to talk about is what I'm considering a very large threat to where you currently are. And it's Initiative Petition 28, which is currently slated for the November ballot here in Oregon. The proponents of this initiative are in the signature gathering stage right now. They have to gather, I believe it's 88,000 signatures before July. But I think most people expect that they will meet that threshold and this will be on the ballot in November. So what is it? It would impose a 2.5% gross receipts tax on all corporations with more than $25 million in Oregon sales. Now, I will note this is sales in the state of Oregon. It's not where the company is located. So you could have a firm in the state of Oregon that sells more than $25 million, or you could have an out-of-state firm that sells more than $25 million in the state. Both of those entities would be affected by this tax. About 1,000 firms are estimated to be affected, according to the state of Oregon. And if you look at the most recent data from the Department of Revenue, about half of those firms would be between $25 and $50 million in sales. It is not the extremely large companies. It's a lot of very small, medium-sized businesses that would be affected. It's estimated to raise about $5 billion in revenue. And right, these numbers are huge, and sometimes you need some context. So think about it this way. This is a 40% increase in the Oregon state budget if it passes. It increases corporate tax collections by 440%. So I live in Washington, D.C., and if you watch the national news during a tax debate, if we think back, there was a big tax fight at the end of 2012, beginning of 2013, it raised $500 billion over 10 years. Seems like a huge tax. It was $500 billion compared to $45 trillion, right? This is a couple percentage points. So in D.C., D.C. can almost shut down over a 3 or 4 percentage point tax increase. This is 40%. This is a truly large tax. So how does this work? I mentioned this before, but currently corporations in Oregon pay 6.6 or 7.6% of their income in the corporate income tax. But there's also a minimum tax. So what does this mean? It means that if you go through to go file your taxes and you have a loss as a corporation or you have don't have taxable income, there is a minimum. You have to at least pay this month. So for a firm with $25 million in sales, you have to pay at least $30,000. You pay the greater of the two, so either the corporate income tax or the minimum tax. But IP 28 changes that structure. And so what it does is it modifies that underlying minimum tax. And it says that instead of it being $30,000 if you have $25 million in sales, it changes it to $30,001 plus 2.5% of all of your sales over $25 million. So if you have a firm that say makes has $30 million in sales, they would pay $30,001 plus 2.5% of $5 million to the state. Functionally, your corporate income tax will switch to a gross receipts tax. The corporate income tax will still exist because this is modifying that minimum tax. So you're actually going to have a lot of even more complexity. Firms will still have to completely figure out their corporate income tax liabilities. But then they would likely pay the minimum tax gross receipts. It's hard to mathematically come up with an equation in which the minimum tax, the new gross receipts tax, is not the greater of the two. But they would still have to comply with the corporate income tax component. So why is this a bad idea? Gross receipts taxes are considered in the economic literature to be one of the worst types of taxes. And there's a few reasons for that. It sounds like it's a sales tax, right? This is what it sounds like. You're going to pay a percentage of your sales over a certain threshold. But it varies a great deal from a sales tax because of how the tax functions through the economy. So if we talk about a sales tax, let's take, you go to the grocery store here. Let's assume you have a 5% sales tax in Oregon, which is about the average of state sales taxes, and someone buys a $3 gallon of milk. They're going to pay 5% of $3. The grocery store will collect that and remit that to the state. That's how a sales tax works. And traditionally, you only want it to hit final sales. You don't want it to hit, you want to exempt business inputs. You want to exempt those intermediate steps. Because otherwise, this occurs. This is called tax pyramiding, and this is what occurs under gross receipts tax. So the dairy, if they're over $25 million in sales, they will pay 2.5%, which means the cost for the packager has gone up a bit. And now the packager, if they have more than $25 million in sales, they're going to pay a tax. And then this continues to the distributor and to the grocer. And by the time the mother of two kids goes to buy the $3 gallon of milk, it's much more than $3. Because the tax from all of those previous sectors of the economy has now been pyramided, it's cascaded, it's compounded into that price of milk. So ideally, under a sales tax, you would exempt those business inputs. You would prevent this sort of pyramiding. But a gross receipts tax does the exact opposite of what you want a sales tax to do. And so what does this mean? Some firms are going to be hurt more than others. A key principle to sound tax policy is what we call neutrality. It's this idea that two firms or two individuals that are similarly situated, they should be affected the same way. And a gross receipts tax is not neutral at all. In fact, you can look at this and you can guess where I'm gonna go with this likely, but firms that have longer production cycles are hit harder. So firms that are, maybe a firm that's vertically integrated, if they own all of that in-house, they would have the effect of the tax once. But if you have a long production cycle, the pyramiding becomes even larger. Retailers and manufacturers, those are, that are hit the most by these sorts of taxes. And this tax pyramiding can be quite a large amount. So your neighbor to the north, Washington State, has a gross receipts tax that's called the B&O. the state's Department of Revenue did a study and found, for instance, in the food manufacturing sector in Washington, the tax pyramid 6.7 times, meaning I actually am missing a bar and a half on this structure. But these pyramiding effects are very, very large. In addition, I would argue that if IP28 passes, the gross receipts tax in Oregon will be worse than all the other states that have gross receipts taxes. There are five states that have a gross receipts tax. Virginia then has one on the local level. And IP28 will vary from those states in three large ways. The first is going to be the rate. So traditionally, because of these pyramiding effects, the rate is much, much lower. And you think 2.5% seems fairly reasonable, right? I said the national average for sales tax is 5%. But on a gross receipts tax, the average is like less than 0.5%. And this is because of those pyramiding effects. So the B&O in Washington starts at 0.13%. And Ohio, the rate is 0.26%. These rates all vary, but they tend to be under that half point. You're going to be at 2.5%. You are going to be in a league of your own. In fact, of all of the states with a gross receipts tax, only one industry in the entire country will pay a higher rate than what you will in Oregon, and that is the radioactive waste industry in Washington state. So this is very different, I would argue, than radioactive waste in Washington state. And in addition, I kind of alluded to it, but in many of the states, and this is the second reason why IP28 would be worse than many of the others, is many other states vary their rates by industry. So to help minimize some of these pyramiding effects, right, it is an explicit acknowledgement that this pyramiding occurs. They charge different rates for different industries. So the B&O in Washington has 30 rates. And Nevada, which created a gross receipts tax last year, they have about 25 rates. In Delaware, there's a couple dozen. And they vary the rates by the amount of pyramiding that occurs in those industries. Your rate will not be varied by industry. It will be 2.5% for all industries. And then finally, some states also try to minimize the downsides of gross receipts taxes by allowing some sort of deduction for cost. So for instance, in Texas, you can make a decision of whether you want to deduct some of your cost of goods sold or some of your payroll. It's moving it closer to an income tax. It's not an income tax, but you're moving in that direction. IP28 also has no allowances for cost. So you're talking about a higher rate than any place in the country, minus the radioactive waste in Washington. You're going to be talking about no industry diversification. So there's no allowances for industries that will be hit harder than others. And you're talking about no additional considerations for cost, right? But so I can talk about this all day and what effect this has for corporations, et cetera, right? You're like, the economist is boring me at this point. I understand. But what does this really mean, right? Like, who is actually be affected by this, right? The question is not, should corporations pay more taxes? The question is, how do corporations pay taxes? And they pay taxes through consumers and workers. So that gallon of milk at the grocery store is going to cost more. The loaf of bread is going to cost more. The cost of your water is going to cost more. The electricity that you pay is going to cost more, because of the fact that these businesses will be affected. And so even if you are a smaller business, you say, oh, I don't have $25 million in sales. Nicole, this is all great, but like this isn't going to affect me. I would argue that it would, not only on the personal side, but your electricity costs are going to be higher if this tax passes. Your input cost will be higher, because if anywhere in your production cycle, anywhere in your supply chain, you have a business that has $25 million in Oregon sales, their costs will be higher. So consumers will be paying a great deal more. In addition, employers are going to face some very tough decisions. Do you cut hours? Do you cut wages? Do you cut benefits? Do you not hire as quickly as you otherwise would? Do you unfortunately have to lay individuals off? These are all likely very, very tough decisions that employers in Oregon are going to have to face as they grapple with the consequences of these tax. So I can be up here all day talking about corporations and their tax burdens and tax shifting, but the real effect of this tax is on consumers and on workers here in the state of Oregon. So we talked about that business tax climate index at the very beginning. We talked about the fact that you're 37th in the corporate component, not your strongest place in the index. If IP28 passes, you will fall to 50. you will have the worst corporate income tax structure in the entire country. This is not a distinction that I think anyone in this room wants to have, right? And your overall ranking will fall from 11th to 17th. This will be a very, very dramatic drop in the index. So you're probably like, well, why do I trust the tax economist from Washington, D.C.? She doesn't live here. What does she know? We're different. Well, I'll tell you that the state's own economists agree with me. The Oregon Legislative Revenue Office released a study of a 0.4% gross receipts tax, so at 1/8 of the rate of what we're talking about. And they said that it would raise about $1 billion in revenue. So again, $1 billion versus $5 billion. They said 15,000 private sector jobs would be lost as a result of this tax. They said that retailers and manufacturers would be hit hardest, as I said. They also said, I didn't put a bullet point in here, but I will note that they also made a point to acknowledge that real income in the state will go down, disposable income will go down, reflecting those higher costs that consumers will face. individual income for individuals, the effect of that after tax will also impact. So I have been told that they are actually trying to do analysis of IP28 specifically to give us what the real effect of this as currently drafted would be. I can't say that it's going to be directly proportional to what the 0.4% will be. Again, the rate is 8 times higher, but I can't say that it's going to have 8 times the job losses. I feel fairly comfortable saying that the job loss figures will be larger. I feel fairly comfortable saying that the real income effects will be larger than at the 0.4%, but I can't tell you how large. We'll have to wait for their analysis. But I will point out that what I am saying and what they are saying is really mirror images at this point. So. Conclusions. Like I said, you will do some things well here. You don't have a lot of rates in your corporate income tax code. This is good. You don't have a capital stock tax. You don't have a real estate transfer tax. You make some things simpler than other states do. This is good. You do have higher rates than I would like to see on both your individual and your corporate income taxes. I'd like those rates to be lower. But really, the big question is what happens with IP28, falling from 37th best corporate income tax climate to the 50th best or the worst. But really, those effects will harm growth, they'll harm consumers, and they'll harm workers. So with that, I think we have a time for a few minutes of questions. And I will just say that if you have questions about our State Business Tax Climate Index, anything I've gone over today, please visit our website at taxfoundation.org. We will be having a report come out in the next few weeks on IP28. It will reflect basically what I've discussed here today. But that will be available there for you all to read, peruse, and share with your friends and family here in the state. So thank you.
Great job, Nicole. We do have some time for some questions, so if you could raise your hand or stand up, that would be great. Yes.
Ron.
So IP28, my understanding is being the proponents are a group called Better Oregon. Yeah, they're using Better Oregon as their name for this, but the group has a longer structure under the name of Our Oregon.
Oh, yeah, I'm sorry. Do we know who the major people
I will
or players
let the representative answer that question.
It is public employee unions. And that was this is one of, I think, 6 or 8 initiatives that were filed after kind of the grand bargain to try to reduce PERS liability across the state for public institutions.
I can't speak to that. I don't live in Oregon. I'm not sure. I would let one of the other individuals in the room handle that question.
Good question.
Can you repeat the question?
Yeah, so
please?
The question was that had to do with the sales tax in Oregon of what effect would it be in the index if we put in a sales tax? I thought about that on the plane right out here, that I should have just created like a traditional sample one to see what that effect was. And I didn't, and I apologize that I do not know that number off the top of my head.
We'll get the mic to you.
Yeah, go ahead. I can always repeat the question.
So would this apply, IP 28 apply to corporations headquartered in Oregon, or would it apply to?
The question was, does IP 28 only apply to corporations that are headquartered in Oregon, or how does that work? There's a really, really complicated concept in corporate income taxes called apportionment. It's how do you decide for a multi-state company how much of their income gets taxed by the various states. Here in Oregon, you all use what's called single sales factor. That means you only look at sales within the state. And so this would apply to any company. It does not matter where they are located, where their corporation is set up. It's only their sales in the state of Oregon, and if those sales are above $25 million. But even if you are in Oregon and you're not at that level, like I said, a lot of your input costs could be higher, so you could feel some more indirect effects of this. Go ahead.
So Nicole, I'm gonna jump in here and ask a question about what type of corporations does this affect?
Oh, so that's a good point. Because this is changing the corporate income tax minimum tax, this does only apply to C corporations, those that file as corporations. If you are set up as an LLC or a partnership or an S corporation, though you file under the individual code, so you would not be directly affected. But again, those indirect effects could definitely happen as well. And I saw there was one out there.
Hi, my name's Hunter Neubauer. I own a vertically integrated cannabis company, and we do have a sales tax in Oregon. It is the first sales tax. It's at 17% at retail sales, and it seemed to have slipped by everybody. I'm kind of surprised to see that there wasn't more of an uproar of the first sales tax in Oregon. Your thoughts on a slippery slope?
I can't speak to that. We would consider that more of an excise tax than a sales tax. That's, again, getting to be a tax economist nerdy discussion. So that is not a factor in our index. We do not include the taxation of cannabis as something we look at. But we do look at other excise taxes on our website. You would find information about the taxes on beer, alcohol, spirits, wine, et cetera, as well as cigarettes and gasoline. Those are kind of the big excise taxes that we look at. Yes, a lodging tax, et cetera.
So let's assume that we want to increase the budget of the state of Oregon to pay for different services. How would you?
So the question was, so if you want to increase the size of the Oregon state budget, how do you do that? So first, I will point out that I am a tax economist. I am not a spending expert, though I have done that previously. That is a policy decision, first of all, that you all need to make in this room in conjunction with your governor and with your policymakers as to what is the amount of revenue that the state wants to collect. You all need to make that decision first. But what I can say is if you are going to raise revenue, one, there are much better ways than a gross receipts tax to do it. I think looking at things like reforming your corporate income tax code as it currently stands absolutely makes sense. Looking at reforms to your individual tax code absolutely makes sense. I know it's not popular in Oregon, but a sales tax is one of the better ways to raise revenue. I know I'm not going to make a lot of friends with that statement here. but looking at those things would be important. Looking at how property taxes are collected as well as a component. It seems to me that Oregon is primed for a large discussion about tax reform and what should be done. But I don't think gross receipts is the way to do it.
When you look at states that have climbed up in the rankings, do you see any common threads, any things that states are doing well that are causing increases?
So the question was, when we look at states that are moving in the index, what is really driving it? So I'll talk about North Carolina. North Carolina in 2013 passed an incredibly large tax reform package. They were 44th in the index in 2012. After it was passed, they were 17. They are as high as 15, I believe, now, and should get as high as 13 once a few other things phase in. So what did North Carolina do? It did a ton of things. One, it lowered corporate income tax rates. It lowered individual income tax rates. It consolidated brackets. It made the tax code broader and lower. They also added some revenue triggers to make sure the state's budget was solid. And they said that if we meet this revenue target, then we will cut it further. And they put those out. I believe those go out through 2017 or 2018. In addition, they have a sales tax. They broaden their sales tax. So many states only tax goods in their sales tax, and that's largely a historical anomaly. When sales taxes were created in the 30s and 40s, most of the economy was goods-based. But now much of the economy is service industries. So they lower their sales tax rate as well. They broadened it to include services. They did, of course, make sure to exempt business inputs. Like I mentioned, that's a principle that is important in sales taxation. They also did some things to help with equity. They looked at expanding their standard deduction, which is the amount of income you can receive every year that's not taxable. They expanded a few other things to help offset some of the regressivity of a couple of those reforms. But overall, they did a full, complete overhaul of their tax code that really hit corporate income, it hit individual income, it hit sales taxes, and as a result, they've climbed very high in the index. And there have been a few other states. Indiana has been doing similar reforms the last few years that have really tried to tackle these tough issues of how do we reform our state's tax code to make us more competitive, not only with our neighboring states, but states across the country.
Thanks so much
for
coming on the way. Thank you. Well, one thing we try to do at EDCO is we try to dive into the meat and dig into some of these issues, and hopefully this was informative and certainly thought-provoking. If you're walking away with lunch from lunch with indigestion, I just will offer up the fact that there are some efforts up front to actually, combat this. It will take quite a fight, a moneyed fight, actually. We've heard estimates of $10 to $15 million on either side of this will be spent in the upcoming election in November. So I don't think there's probably any prospect where this will not wind up in the November ballot as an initiative. So if you're interested in getting involved and learning more about how this impacts your business, or if you've already kind of made that conclusion, want to kind of join up in the effort that would hopefully promote some broader thinking about tax policy and reform in the state. We actually have a couple folks in the back there. Jeremy Rogers is here with the and Jamie Crispin with the Bend Chamber. Jeremy Rogers is with the Oregon Business Council. They put together the Oregon Business Plan. They have some information with a group that, interestingly enough, is called Grow Oregon Now. That is got a lot of folks who are concerned about that, including EDCO. So if you've got information in the back corner over there as you leave, feel free to grab some information, talk to them about that as well. So we're going to wrap up and let you guys get on with your day, but I again want to thank our title sponsor, OSU Cascades, our keynote sponsor, Jones and Roth. Thank you very much. Our event sponsors, Bank the Cascades. There's a great turnout today from your team here, as well as Bryant, Loveland, and Jarvis. Thank you so much for your longtime support, as well as Business Oregon and their partnership with EDCO. Again, thank the Riverhouse and their incredible staff that put on an awesome event this afternoon. And then hand-in-hand productions in the back. Guys, nice job. Thanks so much, and have a great day.